In discussions of the theater of Lope de Vega, one frequently finds three of his works grouped together as if they constituted some kind of trilogy. Those works are Fuente Obiguna, Derivar y Fiel Comen la Bola de Ocaña, and El Mejor Alcalde de Gabore. There are, of course, valid reasons for linking them to each other. All three plays take place in the countryside of Spain, which is evoked as a kind of earthly paradise. All three present an idealized vision of the peasants who are the principal inhabitants of that world, depicting them as loving, honorable, and dignified. And all three feature as villain a nobleman who abuses his power in a number of ways, principally by attempting to force himself on one or more of the peasant women who are his vassals, thus offending both the purity of the women and the honor of those men who are responsible for their care. Are you hearing me all right this morning? Nevertheless, there is a significant distinction that differentiates El Mejor Alcalde del Rey from the other players. In Fuente Obiguna, in Peribáñez, the peasant heroes react to the heinous actions of the villainous noble by taking matters into their own hands and killing him. These two works, then, are honor plays, plays in which the dramatic interest centers on the vengeance undertaken by the male protagonist, or protagonists, in order to recover honor that was diminished or destroyed because of the predatory behavior of another male. In El Mejor Alcalde del Rey, however, there is no vengeance as such, although there is a bloody punishment, and the thematic interest of the play, of those plays are quite different from is quite different from those of a typical honor play. Chief among those interests, as the title itself of the work indicates, is the celebration of monarchy. The plot of El Mejor Alcalde del Rey is based on an incident related in the fourth book of Florian de Ocampo's version of the Crónica General de España. Following his usual practice, however, when dramatizing stories borrowed from history or legend, Lope has here taken considerable liberties with his source material, modifying it in ways both large and small to give it greater theatrical effect. I apologize, I'm dealing with congestion issues this morning. As related by Ocampo, the incident in question took place in the early 12th century, during the reign of Alfonso VII of Castile and Leon, and had to do with a Galician nobleman's usurpation of lands belonging to a neighboring peasant. When the peasant was unable to recover the lands in his own, he sought restoration by petitioning the intervention of Alfonso himself. The king, who was known throughout his realms as a very just monarch, first sought to aid the peasant by sending the malefactor a letter in which he ordered him to return the sequestered lands. When this letter was ignored by the infanto, the king traveled in person from his palace in Toledo to the bajo of the nobleman in Galicia. Upon his arrival there, he commanded the wrongdoer to appear, pronounced judgment upon him for compounding the theft of the lands and the crime of lese majeste, and ordered him to be hanged in front of his own doorway. In his reworking of the incident from Ocampo, Lope has taken care to supply his major male characters, Alfonso himself, Sancho the peasant, and Don Pedro the nobleman, with a specificity of identity that is largely missing in the sword work. He has furthermore placed them in surroundings that not only serve to ground the action of the play, but that, with their obvious mythic overtones, also function to enhance its thematic concerns. Finally, he has added another major character, Elvira, the betrothed of Sancho, and she is in some sense the center of the play, for in Lope's retelling of the story, what Don Pedro steals from Sancho is not his lands, but Elvira, his intended bride. Seeing her for the first time on the night of her wedding, he is overwhelmed by her extraordinary beauty, and he decides that he must have her. Ordering the ceremony postponed, he then has Elvira abducted under cover of darkness to his nearby castle. With this change, Lope's play becomes an archetypal rescue story. For once Don Pedro has carried off Elvira, thus raping her in the original sense of the word, It is imperative that Sancho, and later the king, do all they can to save her. Such stories of abduction, prostration, and deliverance are, of course, as old as the earliest Greek tales and as new as the latest Hollywood movie. And from time to time, they make their inevitable appearance in Golden Age drama. Much of their appeal has to do, undoubtedly, with the highly effective manner in which they exploit some of the most enduring archetypes of world fiction. The brave and determined hero, the innocent and imperiled maiden, and the dangerous and heartless villain, along with the symbolic oppositions that attach themselves to the struggle of the three characters, good versus evil, light versus darkness, summer versus winter. Over the ages, rescue stories have, of course, assumed many different forms. In the case of El Mejor Alcalde or Beg, I would argue that its underlying structure reflects the pattern of what the eminent anthropologist Victor Turner has called a social drama. As defined by Turner, social dramas are highly charged sequences of events that take place within a given ethnic, cultural, or political group, one that is bound together by a shared history and by common values and beliefs. The events of these social dramas follow one another in the same order, an order that in Turner's scheme has four principal phases: breach, crisis, redress, and the final stage that can be either reintegration or recognition or schism. Breach occurs when there is a public infraction of the norms of a given society. The breach may pertain to the rule of law, but it may also have to do with accepted custom, morality, or even etiquette. Whatever the case, the violation, once known, leads quickly to a state of crisis, a turning point in the unfolding drama, in which harmony breaks down, antagonisms come into the open, and sides are taken. At this juncture, Turner writes, unless the crisis is quickly contained, there is, quote, a tendency for the breach to widen and spread until it coincides with some dominant cleavage in the widest set of social relations to which the parties in conflict belong, close quote. Often, however, before total breakdown occurs, mechanisms of redress come into being. Sometimes these are informal, consisting, for example, of private appeals or discussion in council among the parties most affected.